Hey guys, welcome back. Thanks for joining me for another video. If you guys are new to my channel, my name is Stephanie. I'm a life and relationship coach. I am really excited about this week's topic. I want to talk about breakups, divorces. I want to talk about disappointments. I want to talk about really just those letdowns that we go through in life when it comes to relationships. If you like Google how to get over a breakup, a lot of the things that someone will write about or talk about is, you know, surround yourself with your friends and, you know, be active and go shopping if you need to and hang out with the boys, and all of that stuff is great stuff. But really all of that stuff is band-aids. So we're not really getting to the healing that needs to happen. You know, being around friends and family, that feels good. But what happens when it's Friday night and we don't have plans and we're lonely? What happens when it's Tuesday and we're missing that person that we were with, or we're devastated about the divorce that we're going through? Like, those are the moments where real healing begins. So in this video, I want to give you three practices that you need to do in those moments. So instead of saying, okay, I'm not going to deal with what I'm feeling right now, I'm just going to push it aside and I'm going to work, or I'm going to hang out with friends, or whatever distraction that you're going to, right? I'm going to eat, whatever. This is the stuff that you need to do in those moments. So the very first thing that you have to do when you are going through this process, I don't care if it's a breakup, I don't care if you just ended a relationship with a friend, I don't care if you just found out someone's cheating on you, divorce, whatever, right? Just any kind of letdown and disappointment. You have to feel what you're feeling. You cannot suppress what you're feeling. And I think that we've been so programmed in life to suppress what we feel because we were never taught how to feel, right? What are the things that we hear parents sometimes tell children? Don't feel that way. You shouldn't feel that way. Oh, you feel upset? Don't feel upset. We don't allow our children to feel what it is they need to feel. Doesn't mean they're going to stay stuck in that space, but you have to allow the feeling to come up. You have to be okay with welcoming what it is that we're feeling in order for it to come up. And then we decide what we want to do with the feeling and we move through the feeling, right? We use logic to get ourselves through that feeling. But if we never feel it, then it just stays stuck in us. So the first thing is, do not suppress what you're feeling. You have to welcome what you're feeling, and because it's just a feeling. And a lot of times people are so scared to feel something that they never feel anything at all. And I know I've met people in my life that don't ever feel. And it's the oddest thing to me that they don't know how to feel their feelings, or sometimes they don't even know what they're feeling. So welcoming feelings, no matter what it is, not judging the feeling. So the minute you feel something, there is no judgment of, why do you feel that way? You shouldn't feel that way. It's been so long now. You shouldn't be feeling that anymore. You should be over this. There's like none of that. And I always talk, and I'm gonna go right into number two. I always talk about self-parenting, and the reason why, learning how to be the parent for yourself. We all have a little child inside of us, right? We can go into psychology and you can think it's hoity-toity to have like a little girl inside of me or a little boy inside of me, but the reality is that you do. So that's life. You have a wounded, scared little part of yourself, and it comes from that wounded ego sometimes, it comes from that wounded self, and sometimes it gets really sad that it gets angry. Because remember, all anger is just a symptom of sadness, of disappointment, right? So when we feel anger, frustration, you know, all those feelings that are coming from that ego, that wounded self, that part of ourself needs love, validation, compassion, understanding, in order for that feeling to go away and subside, right? So in order for us to move through that feeling. Now, I always use the analogy of having children, because sometimes it's easy for people to understand this, but if you don't have children, you can just think of what you wanted your mom or your dad to say to you, right? So if I'm feeling sad that I'm going through this divorce, if I'm feeling upset because I had to end this relationship or someone left me, and I'm feeling like, hey, I feel really sad about this, and a thought comes in of, well, you shouldn't feel that way. Why do you feel that way? That's silly to feel that way. Think about a parent saying, think about your parents saying that to you as a child. Now you're a 7-year-old child, right? You have this feeling and that's what your parent says to you. Think about how crappy that would make that child feel, because that's what you're doing to yourself. Now, if you have children, think about one of your children coming to you later on in life. Dad, I'm going through a divorce. Mom, I just had to break up with this guy. Mom, this guy just cheated on me. Or whatever the situation is, right? They come to you. They're being vulnerable with you. They're opening up to you. They're trusting you with their heart because they're being real. And they're looking for validation. They're looking for compassion. They're looking for love and understanding, right? And they open up to you and you immediately shame them, make them feel bad for what it is that they're feeling, not validating what it is that they're feeling. Think about how crappy that would your child would feel. And most likely, most parents would never say that to their child. And I think that that's huge, because a lot of the times, the things that we say to ourselves, we would never say that to our children. You know, a lot of self-parenting has to do with your mental toughness. So it has to do with you being the adult of what it is that you're thinking and you choosing your thoughts. So we're emotional creatures. So a lot of the times our thoughts are coming from a lot of places in our subconscious and things that are just kind of in there, wounds and just the way we were programmed in life. But when you become mindful, when you take responsibility for yourself in every single moment. So if I take responsibility for my life, I'm going to take responsibility for how I feel in every moment. It doesn't matter if the guy next to me at the red light cuts me off and flips me off. If I react, I take responsibility for that because I don't have to react to him. I could say, okay, he's clearly in a rush. He's clearly having a bad day. He's clearly not really being a nice person. And I could not let that affect me. Now, that takes practice. That's not something that we always can just, you know, do very easily unless you've practiced this stuff time and time again. Staying mentally strong with your emotions, right? So when we're feeling something, we're emotionally entangled in it. Learning how to self-parent and removing the emotion out of it and being the logical parent, being the logical parent that's looking down on your thoughts and seeing the conversation and seeing, okay, this is the wounded child and this is what she's telling me right now. She's telling me that I'm the reason why this divorce is happening. I was a nag. You know, I wasn't cute enough and that's why that he left me. Or I wasn't enough of a man for her and that's why she found someone else. Like the stories that you tell yourself, where these stories are coming from, that scared, wounded part of yourself, you being the adult and saying, I'm taking care of myself and I'm controlling and monitoring these conversations and I'm picking and choosing what I want to believe. And when you see those fear thoughts, those worry thoughts, those thoughts that just bruise your ego and your self-esteem, dissecting those thoughts. Okay, where are they coming from? They're not coming from my true self. They're not coming from my soul. They're not coming from that part of me that's love and that motivates me and the part of me that always is telling me that I'm a good person and I'm loving and I'm caring and I didn't deserve that. That stuff's not coming from that part of me. That's coming from that scared, wounded part. Learning how to do this process is so huge. And this is the stuff that I teach my clients every single day. The next thing is accepting that regardless of how the relationship ended, whether someone walked out on you, whether you're the one that had to come up with the courage to initiate this divorce and now you're so worried about the kids, whether you're the one that ended this relationship and now you're moving out of your apartment with this person, whatever the scenario, accepting that you both did the best that you could. And that's hard to do sometimes, depending on how the relationship ended. Either if you ended it, you having guilt for ending it or thinking that you should have tried harder. If the other person ended it in a bad way, maybe just having anger towards them, towards what they did to you because it was so hurtful and painful, accepting that everyone's doing that the best that they possibly can from the level that they're at, and accepting that maybe at one point in time, you guys were on the same path, headed in the same direction, but life changes sometimes and people change and people outgrow each other. And knowing what you want, when you really know what you want, and you know it's out there, right? So again, knowing it's out there is all about self-parenting. So what am I telling myself? Am I telling myself hopeful thoughts? Am I telling myself that, like, look, this is exactly what I want in a marriage. I want to feel this way. This is what I want in a partner. Or, you know, I'm 33 and I'm ready to get married. I'm ready to settle down. I want to create that family unit. That's important to me. And there's someone out there that would share the same values as me, that would want the same things as me, that communicates the way I do, that even though the grass isn't greener and I'm going to learn things from this person and they're going to frustrate me and we're going to get into disagreements from time to time, that we know how to handle those things together. Those are the best relationships. And also the person that I'm madly in love with. And, you know, I can't stop touching and flirting and all that stuff. When you have all of that, that is literally the best. Knowing that that exists is the toughest part in this whole process. When you know what you want and you know that it exists because you deserve it. Why doesn't it exist? The reason why people think it doesn't exist is because they have a belief that, quite frankly, they don't deserve it. Or they live in the assumptions world where I'm assuming it doesn't exist because I've never had it before. That is, I think it's a ridiculous way of thinking. Because if you're logical, the thought that this person does not exist in the entire world, that doesn't even make sense. And I always say that to people. Whenever they start coming from lack, I always say, so you mean to tell me that there's no one in the city of Boston that is good for you? Like, are you telling me that there's no one in your small town that you could possibly find? There are. But because you don't think that that person exists, you're never going to meet that person. That person's never going to come into your life. It's all about your energy. It's all about your vibration. Those two things are so, so important when you're trying to manifest a great relationship into your life. So ask, believe, and then you receive. So the reason why accepting that you guys did the best you could is that aspect that you really need in terms of forgiveness, forgiving this other person and forgiving yourself for possibly projecting what you wanted onto this person when maybe they weren't that person at all. And I know that that's so common in dating, is we just project. We know what we want, and or we know what we wish we could have, and we project that onto people. And when people don't, when they show us who they are and we don't really believe them, we still take whatever comes along and we still project and project and project, rather than saying, okay, this is what I want. And when I'm not seeing it in you, right, when I'm being vulnerable with you, when I'm showing you who I am, when I'm saying, look, I'm stressed, this is what I've gone through in life, and I'm showing you bits and pieces of myself, how does this person show up for you? Do they make you feel bad for what you're feeling? Do they shame you? Or do they sit in a space for you? You know, it's all about how you feel when you're around people. And if you go off of how you feel, not just how you feel in terms of like, oh, I'm just excited and butterflies and all that stuff. I'm talking logical. I feel good when I'm around you. Being very honest with yourself. This is what I need in a person. I'm going to be honest with myself. And really interviewing people and not getting so emotionally tangled in people before you've really gotten a chance to know them is so, so huge. And so when we forgive ourselves for maybe projecting who we wanted this person to be and they didn't end up being that person, forgiving this person for maybe hurting you or doing the things that they did, right? And accepting the situation for what it is, that's a practice, right? That's huge. And then again, of course, knowing what you want and knowing it exists. When you start really knowing that what you want exists, you get excited about the next phase of your life. And it's easy for you to pick yourself back up because now you're ready for this next phase. Like, you want to open the door and you want to leave the past behind you. That's the best place to be. So I hope that this has helped you to motivate yourself to understand what are the things that I need to do. Self-parenting is huge. If you've never seen my video, go check it out. A lot of my videos, I talk about self-parenting. So again, I hope that helped you. There's a big truck going by my house. Oh, the oil guy. Sorry about that. And I hope you enjoyed this video. Don't forget to like and comment down below. I love reading all of your comments, and I will see you next week.